I'm here at Prismic. I'm here with Chris Heilmann. Chris, can you introduce a bit to yourself? People who don't know you.
Okay, I'm Chris. I've been doing web development for over 20 years. I've been working in different environments, worked on several browsers, wrote several books on JavaScript, and generally try to keep up with everything that's happening. And it's getting more and more interesting. And I love the web from the very beginning, and I love that people build things on it. So I want to make sure that people do it in a way that anybody can consume it.
Right, you worked at Mozilla and then...
I worked at Yahoo, at Mozilla. Now I'm working at Microsoft. I'm working on the Edge browser in Microsoft.
Nice.
That's been the last 4 years, but it doesn't feel like it because I work from home. So it's not the office overload yet.
Right. So we've been talking before about, we discussed a bit about performance and web performance, you know, and you know, a lot of our audience are, you know, people that, who do websites and apps on the web. So I thought that maybe you can introduce a bit the subject of, you know, performance on the web, on the browser, and, you know, how can you manage that? What are the important things for managing performance on a browser?
Yeah, one of the big problems that I see nowadays is that we have too many toys to play with. We have too many things that our computers can do, and we put them on the web and we expect our end users to have the same setup and be able to do the same things.
When you're sitting on a
massive laptop in a fast connection in your office, everything looks smooth and beautiful, but most of your end users will probably be on a mobile device somewhere out there in a bad connectivity, and sometimes even on an old mobile device, and there's nothing you can do about this. The web has been defined as the end user can use whatever they want that is web capable to actually look at your thing. So it's your job as a publisher to make sure the thing performs well. You don't want to be the person that burns through the battery of somebody's mobile phone. You don't want to have that website where people have to wait 15 seconds before the first bit of interaction shows up. And there's a few things we do wrong nowadays. When I look at there's this HTTP archive where you can see the websites, the general websites that we have right now. And on average, a website is 2.2 megabyte. That could be a hello world. That's basically people uploaded lots of images, lots of JavaScript, lots of CSS that they don't need. They just used a framework to create these hello world things and didn't optimize afterwards what could be taken away from it. So it is very important nowadays to think about what you can do about performance, and the tooling to make these things for us has never been better.
Right. And you mentioned several topics, right? You mentioned images, you mentioned the tooling for having set up an environment that looks more like, you know, the clients that you will be facing, all of these kind of different topics. Maybe we can start with images.
Yeah. One of the big problems with images is that people don't optimize them. They just upload them because they look good on their computer. They look crisp and beautiful. And they're like a 5 megabyte JPEG file that is 6,000 pixels wide. Whereas your end user that on the other end will have a mobile phone where a 200 pixel slightly blurry JPEG would be a better experience for them. So for us, it's an opportunity to optimize these images and generate the images that we need for the different environments. There are several things we can do with that. The image element in HTML allows you to give different sources in there, the picture element, not
nice.
The image element.
Yeah.
You can also use your in CSS, you can use media queries to load different images only when they're needed. There are services out there that actually host your images on a CDN to give you the right image in the right format for the right end user, because you don't want to test through all these things yourself.
So that's services that provide that different images for different browsers, right? Or different connections?
Different resolutions, different browsers, different environments, different connections. One of them is Cloudinary. They're a really good provider for that, but there's ImageX.
There's all
kind of people out there for that. One big thing that you have to keep up to date as a web developer is image formats. WebP, for example, is much, much smaller than the JPEG normally is, and the quality is the same, and it's now supported by all the browsers out there. So when you see information that WebP cannot be used anymore, go to caniuse.com, take a look at what formats are available in which browser, and then you see that your end users can actually benefit from a much smaller image that you have before. Google released a tool called squoosh.app, which is a PWA that actually allows you to optimize the images with a visual slider. You can see the difference between them, and you can select the different selectors and different compression formats. So that's a very, very cool tool to actually use upfront to optimize your images before you upload them as well. So think about tooling for your images as well, and don't fall into the trap that it's really easy in a content management system to upload images. You also need to optimize them before they actually go out to the end user.
Yeah, and we are actually, for instance, for us in Prismic, we're contacting different image optimization platforms to be able to do that for the, you know, for the users. But it's kind of it's a lot of processing, and I think the companies that you mentioned, Cloudera and Imagix, they are doing a pretty good job in doing all of that. So moving from that to JavaScript.
Yeah, that's the other big problem. JavaScript is in everything nowadays. And of course, it's really convenient to use a framework that is a lot of JavaScript to do the things for you that the web platform couldn't do before, like proper components, proper separation of concerns in your different components. And that's where something like Angular, React, Vue.js, whatever you want to use is beneficial. At the same time, you're sending a few megabytes of JavaScript to your end user. And that does not only mean that they have to load that JavaScript, and it does not only mean that the browser doesn't have to be able to execute JavaScript. So, for example, if somebody in India or in Africa uses Opera Mini, that's a service that strips your JavaScript out of your website before it starts rendering it. And even if if everything is okay, even if you got a brand new iPhone, a brand new Android device, it still needs a lot of time to download that JavaScript, and even more importantly, it needs a lot of time to execute it. So an older device, like an average mobile phone that you have out on the market, can take up to 2 to 3 seconds to execute a JavaScript that is 2 megabytes. So even if it downloaded fast, you still have that 2 to 3 seconds where your end users get nothing. And that's only for the benefit of you, that it was easier for you to do. So what you can do about this is a few things. You can, first of all, test on a mobile device. Get a really, really mid-level phone. Get a SIM card in there, make sure it's actually in a bad part of your office, so where the connectivity isn't perfect, and try it out on that and optimize for that thing. Everybody will benefit from that because it will be greater on a desktop as well. The other thing to do is...
Maybe also, I mean, you made me think of it. Sometimes it's maybe scary to do that because, you know, maybe you're having this idea that maybe everything will break in this kind of conditions. Maybe you just integrate it into your working programming process. Like, you know, you have it next to you all the time. You're testing all the time instead of like having it as something by the end of the project where you test and you discover that everything is broken anyway.
Definitely, but it's better than it breaks for you than for your end users.
Yeah, of course.
But
of course.
Developer tools are a great example as well. All of them have simulated connectivity in them now as well. So you can slow down the connection of your computer to see what the simulated mobile phone in the developer tools or the mobile device can do. It doesn't replicate fully the experience of an end user because you have also the interaction models of a mobile phone that can only be simulated on desktop. But it's a good start as well. So making sure that your JavaScript is optimized for the use case and for the end user. And this is where tooling comes in as well. Webpack, for example, or other loaders that we have right now can optimize the JavaScript that you send down the wire for the different use cases. So you don't give the full React to everybody. You only give the things that you're using there. Audits in developer tools tell you which of the JavaScript that you have actually was executed by a certain use case, rather than like which one just was downloaded and slowed down the thing without having any effect. So all of these tools that we have these days allow us to send the right amount of JavaScript to the right amount of users. I'm not saying that you should not use JavaScript because it's far too beneficial to actually give up on that. But you got to make sure that it actually comes to the benefit of your end users, not the convenience of you as a developer.
And there are a lot of times where, you know, and that's maybe another topic that we can explore further whenever, like, you can use CSS instead. Well, use CSS instead of using JavaScript, right?
Definitely. CSS has come a long way that we, but it's a lot of people, it's harder to learn because it's not coming from a normal programming paradigm that we learned in school, so to say. But CSS does animations, CSS does transitions, CSS does all kind of conversions for us as well. And the good thing about CSS is that it is hardware accelerated by the browser. The browser does the job for you. Whereas in JavaScript, if you try to control everything, you're also responsible for everything. You're responsible to make sure this thing performs well.
Right.
Whereas with CSS, a lot of it has been done for you by the browser makers to actually validate it. And I find CSS an interesting gap between the different markets that we're doing. Learning CSS is a completely different beast than learning JavaScript. And I find it sad that people don't even look at CSS as a solution. There's a lot of opportunities in there.
Yeah, absolutely. And we'll make one whole discussion about this. So there's another thing, other things. So for the tooling, you mentioned Webpack. Or any other tooling that you would advise developers to?
In general, I would use any testing environment for you. We've got a system called Webhint. Webhint.io is actually a website. You can put your URL in there and tells you all the things that can be optimized about your website. It's about security, it's about performance, it's about accessibility, interoperability of different browsers and different devices, and of also performance. So that's one of the services. That's also a node module that you can put in your continuous integration, for example, that would throw these errors before you put something live. Mm. That hurts much more than maybe testing it while you're developing. And it's a good gatekeeper to make sure that your end users don't get a slow performing website. Developer tools in general in the browsers have all these built things built in. The Google developer tools, Chrome developer tools have Lighthouse built in, which has these audits. So they do performance testing for you as well and simulation of how something performs on different devices. Take it with a grain of salt because it's kind of it has a certain goal to it. But I think it's great that we have these tools rather than just being in the blind all the time how the things perform. So these
maybe this is the best, the most important advice. Don't be blind onto what it like. Try to test things and look at them instead of like face the fact that they are running on different devices, and you should take that into account from day zero when you're programming instead of like making it as a secondary thing.
Yeah, in essence, somebody pays you to do that. And most of the time, the money comes from your end users, be it by subscription or be it by numbers. So those people are the ones you don't want to actually antagonize. So make sure that you actually have empathy for their different environments. Test things on your mobile device, do things on the train home, and look at the thing that you've done today. And then you realize actually how much it isn't the performance that you think it is. We should not be arrogant to think everybody should have a certain setup to be on the web. Everybody's invited, and your job is to make sure it performs.
And as you said, this is the definition of web, right?
Absolutely. That was what the web was meant to be.
And there's another thing that getting a lot of attention, GraphQL, you know, and maybe it enters into the land of optimization, do you think?
Definitely. The benefit of GraphQL versus other ways of REST APIs that we had in the past is that instead of downloading a massive chunk of data and then doing the filtering on the device to know what you need to have, you download only what you need. I used to work on YQL when I was in Yahoo. That was kind of similar to that as well, where instead of saying like, I need these 50 images, you actually only need the titles of these images. So why do you request all of the other data that has to be downloaded, has to be converted, has to be calculated on the device, and actually makes it slower. So with GraphQL, I got the same opportunity. I filter before I request rather than like, I have to filter after I requested and download a lot of unnecessary data. So there's a lot of power in GraphQL, of course. It's a kind of a hurdle to set up your GraphQL server and to use it. That might be an overhead that you don't need. But if you have a data intensive app, it's a very, very good way to only request what you need when you need it, rather than just keeping everything in memory and slowing down the whole process.
And there are services, already providing APIs in like their APIs as GraphQL out of the box. And also there is, for instance, frameworks like Gatsby, like will convert anything into GraphQL. So that also could be a solution for...
Definitely. I mean, the endpoint where you get your API from, I remember when we had to fight for JSON endpoints and we only got XML ones. But nowadays we live in a great world where people that provide APIs also know about performance. So if you get a chance to use something like GraphQL to only get what you need at the time when you need it, that's a great opportunity for you.
So we'll end up with perspective. What do you think that, you know, in the new standards or in the recent standards of the web, what are the opportunities for performance?
There's great opportunities there. The whole moving from HTTP to HTTPS and HTTP2 changes the whole plumbing of the internet. The way we request data, the way we had to chunk things into different bytes or images into one big image to have a sprite sheet and these things become not that necessary any longer. And sometimes things like encoding something into a binary format that was good is now actually an anti-pattern. So keeping up to date with what's happening in the HTTP and HTTP2 space is a very interesting one. The same is like file streams are an interesting one. Rather than just loading a whole file, you load it on, you load it one after the other and only use the things that you need to do with that. Something that is very, very, that is now available and we should be using much more is service workers. Service workers is in essence an opportunity for you to define what part of your application should be stored on the end user's device and be available from the end user's device when they're actually accessing your website. So even if you don't want to build an app, your progressive web app or something like that, it's a great opportunity to have your resources in a predictable fashion coming from the device rather than coming from the server when the user goes there every single time. So instead of hoping that the browser caches something for you, you can tell the browser to cache it, and you can name that cache, and you can invalidate that cache and rename that cache when you need to. So there's an opportunity for you to make, say, okay, my app needs so and so many megabyte for something. I want, when it's available, to store it on the device of the end user, so that most powerful end user devices become an opportunity for you to make your thing much more performant.
So for instance, things like, I don't know, nav bars, footers, all these kind of things.
Anything that doesn't assets, change.
Yeah, anything that doesn't
anything
change.
That doesn't change is a good opportunity to be rendered from the user's device, because even when they're offline, they get a functionality that way. So we used to have 404s, like error pages when something could not be found. Mm. And there was a lot of UX on how to make the perfect 404. Nowadays, we have an opportunity to make an offline page to tell people like, this is offline right now, but you can still enter this and we keep it in local storage. And when you go online, then we sync it for you. So whenever I take my phone out and I can use your system, even if I'm offline, that's a great experience. And I'd be a fan of your product. If it tells me you're offline, see you later, I'm not going to come back, I guess.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Chris, very much for this.
You're welcome. Detail.